We are discussing about the need of missions, and let me tell you today, I'll be really running short of time, and I'll be in a little hurry today so that I'm able to communicate to you the vision that we have about the mission. And we had started with the need of missions, and from there on, we actually went in, you know, what do you think about missions? We discussed about that, and we also discussed a few things. Have you heard about it? The way you have heard about it, the reason we have not heard about it, or the other thing that I brought to you yesterday was, have we heard about it the right way? And it is so important, because if you don't hear it the right way, it can be disastrous. What you hear will impact your thinking, and the way you think is the way that you're going to work. And so it is very important that we understand how we think and how we hear and how we think and how we work. So all these things are related to each other. And now today, like yesterday, I wanted, as we were talking about certain things, we were discussing about our ambitions, and I had to wind up with this verse, which I had forgotten and I missed it. I'm sorry, but it is in 2 Corinthians 5 and verse 9. Our ambitions, our aim, our goal should be to please Him. It says, therefore, we also have an aim, or therefore, we also have an ambition, whether at home or absent, to be pleasing Him. That is all that your ambition has to be, that you are pleasing Him. Your life has to be such that in anything that you do, everything that you do, you should be pleasing God. You know, when you please somebody, that person feels so good about it. And what better can you do than pleasing God? And I think that is one of the topics that we could have discussed otherwise, but that is not my topic now, and I won't want to get into that. Oh, so it is, the whole desire is that, you know, whether whatever you do, you should be doing it as unto the Lord. We will get into that matter more, but now let us come to the next point. I think as you see the screen, you will see what it means. And, you know, in creation, what was the purpose as we started in the beginning itself? You know, in the beginning itself, in the creation, what was the purpose and the command? Or the what was command and the promise? Does anybody remember what we had heard that day? What was the command and the promise? On the first day, while we were discussing, we had got into that from Genesis chapter 1 and verse 28.
The command was that you should take care of this creation and you should name them all. And the purpose was to praise God.
Okay. That's good. That's good. You know, when we come back to it, is everyone called for it? We have to understand these two facts, which go in tandem together from the beginning and towards the when we come back into the New Testament. In creation, what was the purpose and the command? What we see is in Genesis chapter 1, verses 28. And Genesis chapter 2, verses 15 to 17. I would like us to go through those verses very fast, if somebody could help me out in reading that, and then we will try to understand what was the promise, what was the command, and how it is so much connected to when we come into the Great Commission. Yeah. Can somebody help me reading Genesis 1, 28, 2, 15, and 17?
Then God blessed them, and God said to them, be fruitful and multiply, fill the earth and subdue it, have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the birds of the air, and over every living thing that moves on the earth. And God said, see, I have given you every herb that yields seeds, which is on the face of all the earth, and every tree whose fruit yields seeds to you, it shall be for food. Uncle, what was the second one?
Yeah, the next one is chapter 2, verses 15 to 17.
Then the Lord God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to tend and keep it. And the Lord God commanded the men, saying, Of every tree of the garden you may freely eat, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat. For in the day that you eat of it, you shall surely die.
Yeah, what we have over here is something that I would like to hurry up today. What we understand from these portions is God created man, and God wanted man to have dominion over all things. He wanted that man should be the one who commands everything. You know, in the first day while we were discussing about this, we had, this is how I had put it across to you, that the command in Genesis was be fruitful, multiply, and then it says subdue it, putting it under your power, have dominion, rule over it. You know, and the blessing was that the blessing and the promise was that if they abide by that, they will become a blessing and they will be fruitful. But instead of ruling over the snake, we saw that on the first day itself, that man was taken in control by the snake and we lost the whole ground. We lost the whole plot. And what has happened today is what we see, that man fell into sin and man lost that glory. So God wanted man to have that glory, the image of God in him. But in the Great Commission, when we come back to Matthew chapter 28, as we come back to those portions in 28 and 19 onwards, let us just go there back and let us read those verses. Matthew chapter 28. Now, God is in the business of restoration and restoration of that glory again. So in Matthew chapter 28, let us read verses 18 to 20. Let us read all of them. 18 to 20. Yeah, can somebody help me reading that?
And Jesus came and spake unto them, saying, All power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. Amen.
You know, in the beginning, God wanted man to have dominion. Now, over here we see is in the Great Commission, again, we come back to the same, therefore go. Who should go? All are commanded to go. Everybody sitting here, small or big, however your age is, it doesn't matter. Everybody is given this commission to go. Nobody can ask me this question, am I supposed to go? Yes, you are kept with a promise and you are protected by this promise that God is going, lo, I am with you even to the ends of the age. That is what the Lord says. So therefore go. Who should go? All are commanded to go. Where to go? To all the nations. And what to do? Subdue all of them back to him, restoring everything back to its past glory. God is in the mission of restoring everything back to the lost glory. That is getting back into the image of Christ. Can somebody help me reading Colossians chapter 3 and verse 10? Very fast. Colossians chapter 3 and verse 10.
And I have put on the new man who is renewed in knowledge according to the image of him who created him.
Yeah, and that is what God wants, you know, the new man that is in us. When we are baptized, the old man is dead and the old man is gone. You are a new creation. And the, you know, in Hindi says, Purani baatein beet gayi. The old is past now. You have a new creation. And then according to the image of him who created him, God wants us back and to be restored into that glory, the glorious image of his son, the beauty and the magnanimity of that Lord Jesus Christ is all that God wants to see. Lord wants to fill, in other words, this is how I would put it, God wants to fill heaven with the image of his son. And you and me should become a bearer of that image, the beauty of Christ, the glory and the majesty of Christ, the holiness and the purity of Christ. The sanctification in our life should be something that portrays Lord Jesus Christ. When you are in the amidst your friends, when you talk, when you open your mouth, when you discourse with them, when you have your communication and when you're in fellowship with them, all that God wants you to be is in the image of Christ. And that is what the mission of God is. And God wants all of us to be working with him, subdue all of them back to him, restoring everything back to its past glory. And that is why he says, go therefore, make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and of the Holy Ghost. The thing is that when we go and preach the gospel, that person says, it is Christ who lives in me. It is no more I, but it is Christ who lives in me. So what happens is the glory is being restored. In Adam, all die, but in Christ shall all be made alive. Death had fallen upon us because of Adam in the Garden of Eden. But now, because of Christ, we shall be made alive. And then it says, the promise is, lo, I am with you always. I am with you always. And that is what God wants to see in our lives. He wants to see that difference. And what we need to understand is that, it's very important for us to understand that we are involved into this mission. We are involved into this mission. God has involved us into this mission. So when we go to the next slide, what we understand from there is that, when you see the next slide, you are called for a mission. It could be put up this way. God could convert everyone using a blinding light that he did, like he did with Paul. But instead, he has given you and me the mission of reconciliation. He wants you and me to be involved into that work. And he wants you and me to go and preach this gospel. Each and every one of you who's sitting here is called by God to be involved into his business. See, when we read Acts chapter 1, verses 8 and 9. Let us read verse 8. Acts of the Apostles, chapter 1 and verse 8. It says, but you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be witnesses to me in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria to the ends of the earth. And that is what the Lord has entrusted this business to us. He wants to work through us, calling sinners to turn to Christ in repentance and faith. That is what the Lord wants us to be involved in. Every one of us can do this job. You are called for a mission. You are called for a mission. And all of us are involved in it. Every one of us who is saved, the day he is saved, the biggest thing that he can tell others is, oh, thank God that I am saved. There will be a difference in your life. Your communication will change. Your personality will change. The way you experience grace will change. The way people will experience grace from your life will change. And if that has not happened, it is time that we look at our own selves and see, has really the Lord worked at that difference in my life? Or you are continuing to be the same? From the day we are saved, God puts us into the business of calling sinners to Christ in repentance and in faith. We are not called just have some gala of a time over here and have some good time with our friends. We all are called to work. We all are called to work. We all are called to work. And that is so important for us to understand that. It is not that we are just called, okay, there are people who are in the lead in the church. There are pastors for us or evangelists for us. There are pastors in the form of elders for us. They are supposed to do everything. We are not supposed to do many things. You know, we are just supposed to go and warm the chairs at the church. No. When you look at the, when we read the Acts of the Apostles, we will understand that. Can somebody help me reading Acts of the Apostles, chapter 11 and verse 18? We will understand who were the first people to be evangelizing, who went around evangelizing. Acts chapter 11 and verse 18.
When they heard these things, they became silent and they glorified God, saying, "Then God has also granted to the Gentiles repentance to life."
Oh, I'm sorry. Let me come back over here. I'm sorry. When we come back. I'm sorry. There is a correction in that reference. It says Acts chapter 8 and verse 1. Acts chapter 1, 8 and verse 1.
"And Saul was consenting to his death, and at that time there was a great persecution against the church, which was in Jerusalem."
At that time there was a great persecution. Listen to it very carefully.
"And they were all scattered abroad throughout the regions of Judea and Samaria, except the apostles."
So, you know, let me read it in a very simpler version. A great wave of persecution began that day, sweeping over the church in Jerusalem, and all the believers, except the apostles, were scattered through the region of Judea and Samaria. So everybody who saved is a believer. And those were the believers who went around preaching this gospel. They went around preaching the gospel. Read verse 4 for me, please.
"Therefore, they that were scattered abroad went everywhere preaching the word."
Yes, this is what it is, you know, but the believers who were scattered preached the good news about Jesus wherever they went. And that is what you and me are called for. That is what you and me are called for. As we go to the next slide, I would like us to understand that, you know, we should not. The problem with the church is very often we have misunderstood the Great Commission. Missions don't end with the salvation of souls, whereas it only begins there. You know, when it says, go and preach the gospel and make disciples, yes, that is when you preach the gospel, that person comes to the saving knowledge of Christ. He's saved. And then what to do? Oh, you need to train him up so that he understands the scriptures and he's baptized. And then what to do? Ho gaya mera kaam. Oh, he's baptized. Let me go away from here. No. That is not where you stop. You have to teach those who believe to observe all that the Lord Jesus Christ had commanded. And it doesn't come in a day's time. It is a long period. It's a long time. It's a time of teaching practical Christianity to these people who have come to the saving knowledge of Christ. You know, when you go through the book of Acts, you will read it again and again as you listen to the conversion of Paul. And then you will see that, you know, they went from city to city preaching. It was just not doing an itinerant preaching, just going there and, you know, 3 days special meeting and ran away from there. No, there were places where they stayed for 6 months. There were places where they stayed for 18 months. They spent a long time over there because they had to teach, they had to instruct them. And then even again, they followed them up by having a second missionary journey wherein, you know, they would go and visit these people and see how they are doing. So that is how the work is supposed to be done. It is not just that the Great Commission means that, you know, you just go and preach the gospel and run away from there. No, that is not how it is. But it is important that we understand how the Great Commission has to be fulfilled. It just doesn't happen, in an overnight's time. You need to invest. You need to spend time. You need to give your life for it. Now let me ask you, how are we involved into the missions? Well, we understand it very clearly that all are to be involved into the missions, but how are we involved into the missions? You know, very often, as we go to the next slide, I've put it in writing for you. Very often we confine evangelism to evangelists, to missions, to evangelism and the evangelist. We think that this is how the mission is. This is how the work is. And that is where we have gone wrong. That is where we have gone wrong. We think that evangelism or missions means, you know, that a person has to be full-time, half-time, part-time, this kind of thing. No, that is not what missions is all about. You are completely involved in the work of the Lord. In fact, it should be that whether we study, whether it is our job, all should be to bring glory to God and be part of an area of our evangelization. Let us read 1 Corinthians chapter 10 and verse 31. Somebody can help me reading 1 Corinthians chapter 10 and verse 31. And somebody else can help me reading Colossians chapter 3 verses 17 and 18.
Whether therefore ye eat or drink or whatsoever ye do, do all to the glory of God.
Oh, whether you eat or drink, do all things to the glory of God. Do all things to the glory of God. You know, when it says eat or drink, that just doesn't mean because you eat and drink. But, you know, when will you eat? When you have earned something. So your job or everything that you do, it will fall into that category. Let us read Colossians chapter 3, 17 and 18 also so that, you know, we get them together and then we go ahead.
And whatever you do in word or deed, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to the God the Father through him. Wives, submit to your husband as it fits.
Okay, let us stop there. Colossians 3:17. And, you know, actually, you could take it from 16 onwards. Let the word of God, Christ, dwell in you richly in all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing with grace in your hearts to the Lord. And whatever you do in word or deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. You know, everything in your life is a part of the mission. Everything in your life is a part of the mission. You know, like I can't come to your school or college and you know, propagate the gospel. But you are the person who's in the school or in the college. And to your friends, I may not have an access, but you have. And so your responsibility is you share the gospel with them. I, as a missionary, may not have an access to them, neither to their homes. But it should start at a very early age. It should start now. Everything is a part of our mission. If that's the case, who can be involved into missions? All. All of us can be involved into missions. You know, I would just like to share to you something that I was once asked at one place about evangelism, and this was the question that came to me as I was up on with the brother who was asking me these questions. It suddenly shocked me. He asked me the question, "So Jim, when did you start evangelizing? When did you start evangelizing?" And you know, I had to think for a while, and then I remembered. I think when I was in upper KG, UKG, is that how you say, Abby? People understand UKG, right?
Senior KG.
Yeah, senior KG, kindergarten. I was in kindergarten. There was a friend of mine, being a Malayali, I always thought that all Malayalis are Christians. So, you know, this friend of mine, he comes and tells me that I am a Hindu. And he's a Malayali. And I said, like, how can it be? And then what happened is I started sharing the gospel to him. whatever way I understood gospel at that age, you know, not that I am saved yet, okay? Not that I'm saved yet, but the fact that I had heard whatever I had heard my father preaching the gospel, whatever I had heard when people would come home and my mother would deal with those people, and the way that they would tell them the gospel of Jesus Christ, how Jesus Christ came into this world, how he died for sinners, and I am one of them, I am a liar, I am a, you know, we fight, we beat, and all those things are sins that we do. And what I understood was that, you know, that was sin. And I tried to tell him that, you know, so there is no other God who has died for us. And I shared the gospel. And I used to continue to do this day after day. And what happened is, one day, suddenly, the parents of this guy reached to my home asking, who is this guy who keeps telling about this Lord Jesus Christ? And finally, my parents were able to communicate the gospel to those parents also. So when do you start it? If you have been hearing about the gospel, let me tell you, if our families have been involved into that, if that was the passion that has been at home, if that was what you have been hearing growing up, oh, you will anytime, any moment, you'll be involved into this mission. So let me encourage you, children. You don't need to be a great pulpit preacher. You don't need to be one guy who knows everything in theology to be into missions of evangelization, of reaching out to the people. You know, the need of the hour is that we start reaching to the communities. The need of the hour is that we start reaching to the communities. You know, how can I be involved in it? You know, that would be the question that you may ask me. How can I be involved into it? I don't think I'm good enough. That is one of the things that very often people come up and tell me. But let me tell you the statement that I write for you. If you are good enough to be saved, you are good enough to serve. You are the most beautiful person on earth that Jesus Christ find worthy of dying for. You were the person on the earth for whom his love was given and shed on the cross. If he could die for you, if the master of the world could die for you, if you were good enough to be saved, you are good enough to serve him also. You know, this is one of the favorite verses of the Bible that I love, which is written over there. Somebody can help reading me. Romans chapter 1, 27 to 29. These are few of the most beautiful words that my villagers love. And they just enjoy reading these verses. Romans chapter 1, verses 27 to 29. Can somebody help me reading those verses?
And the men likewise gave up natural relations with women and were consumed.
Just a second. We are reading Romans chapter 1.
Yeah, I think it's 1 Corinthians 1.
It's 1 Corinthians 1. I'm sorry. 1 Corinthians 1, 27 and 29. My reference is wrong. 1 Corinthians 1, 27 to 29.
But God shows what is foolish in the world to shame the wise. God shows what is weak in the world to shame the strong. God shows what is low and despised in the world, even things that are not, to bring to nothing things that are, so that no human being might boast in the presence of God.
Oh, such a beautiful verse this is, you know. This is the beauty of the Gospels. This is where we have come from. This is what gives us the greatest of all hopes. And this is what I really enjoy reading and again. But God has chosen the foolish things of the world to put to shame the wise. And God has chosen the weak things of the world to put to shame the things which are mighty. To put to shame the things which are mighty. You know, let me read to you something about Fanny Crosby. You know, she was a lady who was blind. Fanny Crosby was a lady who was blind. And she has written for us many of our beautiful hymns that we sing today. And you know how many songs she had written? she wrote more than 8,000 songs, more than 8,000 songs. And what she says is so beautiful. She says, she felt that her blindness was God's gift to her so that she could write songs for His glory. She says, her blindness was God's gift to her. My dear young children, you know, we are talking about fair and lovely. You know, we are talking about complexions. We are talking about kaise dikh raha hai, how our hair should be, you know. But here is a person who's saying that, oh, it was a blessing that I was born blind. And as the writer concludes, he says, in her death, she went and saw her master. What a beautiful statement to end it with. You know, children, it doesn't matter what you look like. It doesn't matter who you are, but it matters if you are working for the greatest master of the world. This is something that I boast about again and again. Rather than name working for the masters of this world, I work for the master of the worlds. That is my Lord Jesus Christ, the King who was and is to come. He's always the King. Oh, think kingdoms may come, people may come, things may change, but one thing doesn't change. Jesus Christ, yesterday, today, and forever the same. And there is no better job than working for Him. So whether it be in your education, whether it be in your studies, whether it be in your college, whether it be in your job, wherever you are, your mission is the proclamation of Jesus Christ in everything, Him being glorified, He having preeminence in whatever you do. But is that the primary focus of our lives? Is something that this morning we need to think over. Is something that we need to think over. You know what? 50% of our nation today is in the age of 0 to 25. 50% of our generation today in India is young people. Young people like you. Let me tell you, if we are able to reach the rest of the 50%, we will be reaching the whole of the nation. It's not something that is impossible, but it is something that we don't want to do because it there is a cost. There is a cost. One out of six people in the world is an Indian. Can you imagine that? One out of six people in the world is an Indian. That is the ratio that we have today. And 40% of people in India live below the poverty line and earns maximum, that is a maximum, 150 per day wages. और हम लोग रोते रहते हैं हमारे घरों में बैठ के पिज्जा नहीं है बर्गर नहीं है. You know, we are not happy about what God has given us. We are not happy about what we have. You know why? Because in everything, we are not glorifying Christ. Well, let me tell you, every time we have a meal on our table, we should be so thankful to God. We should be so thankful to God. Every time you take that meal, you should be so thankful that you have meals on your table. You know, these are not good times. The news that I have been hearing have been very tough. Some children, they have lost their parents, no more parents. Let me tell you one story in our place. You know, the husband was tested positive for COVID. And the wife went along to, you know, to help him and in his treatment. You won't believe, the one day the husband died, the next day the wife died. And the picture that was posted in the newspapers was the people from the village feeding those children, and those children waiting under a tree to hoping that their parents are going to come back. Can you see the need of missions? My dear young ones, can you see the need of missions? There is a great need. We need to understand, you know, the Great Commission very well. The Great Commission, which our Lord gave initially to the 11 disciples, was the starting point of the witness to the gospel, which has spanned the world. It began in Jerusalem, and in the book of Acts, Luke tracks the spread of the gospel into the Gentile world. It continued to spread down through the centuries. And today, the Church of Christ is established in every continent and probably even in your locality. What a God, what a program, and what a vast mission field. But in the bargain in between, there were so many that lost their lives for the sake of the gospel. You know, every 24 hours, there are 480 believers who are being martyred for their faith in Christ. Did you hear those numbers? In every 24 hours, there are 480 believers that are being martyred all around the globe for their faith in Christ. So this gospel that has reached to us, you know, has come up with a price. The Bible that you are holding, my dear young ones, the Bible that you don't take up and read so very often, you know how it has come. It has come because of this man called William Tyndale. You know, because he translated the Bible, because he printed the Bible, because he brought it to the common man, you know, he was burnt alive. That is a price that has been paid for that Bible that you probably pay some 250 rupees or 300 rupees. But so many have died so that you have an access to that Bible. And there is a great need for more people. There is a great need for more people. You know, it's not very easy. It's not very easy. The work is not very easy. In our circumstances itself, we are almost five of us, probably catering to almost 10 villages. Can you see the need? Five of us for 10 villages. Morning, you have to go to one place. Evening, you have to go to one place. You know, and the work of shepherding, taking care of everyone, it's just not that you go and, you know, preach a sermon and come back. No, that is not how missions are. You have to spend time with them. You know, the other day I was listening to a few missionaries and their lives. One of the missionaries that I have as a friend, he was with his brother-in-law and his, because nobody was ready to go to the hospital because it was a COVID ward. And this friend of mine, who's a missionary, he goes and stays with him for more than 10 days and he returns with him COVID negative. Can you imagine that? You know, I have one of my friends, I have one of the other missionaries who, you know, one of the believers was dying because there is no oxygen in the hospital. And while she was dying, she was holding on to the hand of the evangelist, 100% exposed to the COVID. But let me tell you, that evangelist is still alive. That evangelist is still alive. You know, unfortunately, I don't know if it's, you know, I don't know how you would take this. In the first plague that had broken in Rome, to the epidemic in 1920, what we had always seen, that the church never closed its doors. But in fact, with this generation, we spoke and we preached that it's time to close doors and sit at home. But during those pandemics, when the people were on the roads dying, it was the church in the first Roman plague, when it broke out, the whole rich community, they took out everything from the city and they ran into the mountains. But at that time, the Christians that were the persecuted minority, they stayed back in town and took care of people who were, you know, who were suffering with diseases. And it was sure that if they stay back with them, they will die. But they wanted to show the love of Christ and die for Christ. And here we are, you know, a new generation church. We all have shut our doors. We are sitting back at our homes and we say that, yeah, this is the best way to do it. I'm not saying that, you know, go and die with them. Don't be careful. That is not what I mean. But if you are in the missions, let me tell you, brother and sister, let me tell you, young child, you won't be able to leave that sister dying. Because the only hope that you had given to her about Christ is you, and you want to show that love to her, that you are there even in death. That is what missions is all about. That is what missions is all about. You know, Abby, how much time do I have?
Yeah, about 15 minutes. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Now, you know, this is what missions is all about. It is just not, you know, sitting in our comfort zones, you know, and doing what we can do. Arey, jo humse hota hai, wo hum log karenge. You know, my father would very often say, from the Old Testament, there is a verse that was promised to Joshua, that was said to Joshua, there is yet much land to be possessed. And my father would be possessed with this idea. This morning, as we were sitting, my mother was sharing the story when they came to the Koraput in 1970s to drink water. She said, I would have to walk 13 kilometers just to drink water. And my father, I remember him pedaling on his cycle. There were times of hunger. There were times of difficulty. They were not easy times. But I've never seen any kind of, you know, sorrow in him. He would be always rejoicing, ready to go out. You know, he would say this, that there is yet much land to be possessed. Let us go out. Let us go and share the gospel. His passion was evangelism and pastoring his flock. Even today, as I pastor and as I take care of the flock, very often people come and say, you know, you're not like your father. Because I know I probably can't do it like him. I've got all the facilities today. You know, every time I sit into a Jeep that my father had and which I'm driving around, I sit in that Jeep with much tears. Because I know that it is not that I deserve that Jeep. But the Lord had blessed his servant. When he had a cycle, he would at least cover 20 kilometers. Once he got 20 to 40 kilometers. And once he got his bike, he would go away to 80 to 60, 120 kilometers. And once he had a Jeep, he would probably not come for days. And he would take us brothers. You know, I have two more brothers. Their name are Sam and Shim Matthew. And, you know, we were privileged to go with our father to these missions. He would take us. Sometimes we have traveled by bicycle and sometimes by the motorcycle, sometimes by hired matadors and vehicles, you know, which we would go far into the villages. Very often, you know, vehicles which failed starting, self-starting, so we all had to push so that it starts. And, you know, probably sometimes when we would go on our bikes, go in the bike, and after reaching the villages, we would look into the mirror and would be shocked and scared to look at our own selves, because, you know, the dust has probably settled all over our hair and even our eyelashes and everywhere, you know, and like you wouldn't look like Jim Matthew anymore. Until unless you probably go and find some borewell or somewhere to wash yourself so that you make yourself presentable like a human being to be going and talking to the less stressed of the people in the villages. You know, all these things drew us closer to the missions. It was not just my father who was into the missions, but he had already put us into the missions. You know, the times as a young man, there were so many testing times. Struggles of paying the fees and embarrassment in class was something that was normal. Wearing a uniform that was supposed to be maroon, which looked like pink at school, you could be a laughingstock. But you know, my father didn't care. He always said one thing: remember, you're the son of a king. So even if it is a torn cloth, child, always iron it and wear it. Missions was not easy, to the verge where I lost my mind for missions, because if this is how poverty is and this is how the struggles are, I don't want to be into missions. Achha kapda pehno to log complain karenge, ganda kapda pehno to log complain karenge. You wear good clothes, people will complain. You wear bad clothes, people will complain. Oh, it's enough. You know, in 1980s, my father was called to the US by my uncles who were there. And they said, you come over, now it's enough. You know, my father said, see, I am called to this tribal land for missions. If you want to take your sister to a better place, I would rather stay back here and die with the people for whom God has called me for. And he did. He did. He died and he was buried here. Missions were never easy. But let me tell you, the God of the missions is an amazing God. He, if he has said, lo, I am with you, he is always there with you. And he will be there always with you to undertake for all your needs. You know, Abby has come to my home. I would welcome each and every of you young children sitting here. Tell Abby, Uncle Abby, Bia, we want to go to Jagdalpur. Come over, see the missions, be a part of it. You know, I have brethren with whom I work. You know, we've gone through some testing times, one of the brothers who works with us, along with whom I work from the villages, he would have to go on a bicycle almost 20 kilometers to one village. You know, one day as I was crossing from another village on my jeep, I see this man on his cycle and somebody who's wrapped in a tarpaulin completely wrapped in a tarpaulin with a small child. And I see he's got his hand on his umbrella and his wife is sitting with the little baby on the bicycle. He's going to drive these 20 kilometers to one village. And after that, he has to go to the next village, another 13 kilometers after the worship is over there. But you know, you look at him, you will come, and if you meet him, the radiance of the glory of Christ, you will be able to see on his face the joy of being partner into this mission is the joy that he enjoys. These are the brethren. You should come and meet them. I am nothing. You know, it is such a privilege to be serving this God in these mission fields. Let me just wind up this portion with something that I want to tell you about. I want to tell you again, coming back to that great man, David Livingstone. And then I would tell you how can I be involved. I would come to that very soon about David Livingstone. You know, David Livingstone, he became a doctor. He married Mary from a very rich Moffat family that was there in England at that time. David Livingstone, he decided he's going to Africa. When they went to Africa, he saw that there was one kind of illness that could be deadly for his family. So immediately he sent his wife and children back to England. And he told his wife, you know, I will come back as soon as possible. David Livingstone couldn't go home not for 5 days, not for 5 weeks, not for 5 months, but for 5 years he couldn't go back home. What held him back was the people, the perishing souls with whom he was in interaction. 5 years back, he came back home, you know, wobbling into his house. Because while walking in the jungles, one day his eyes was marred. And the other means he was half blind on one eye, and the other eye he had it right. You know, on one of his shoulders was half gone because the tiger had attacked him. When he reached home, probably his wife couldn't recognize him because he was so parched by the heat and the sun in Africa. And then after a few years, they decided as a family to go back to Africa. The day they landed in Africa, his wife contracted that disease that they dreaded so much. And she died over there. And you know, at the grave, this is what somebody heard him saying and praying. Lord, even at this time, take my life, my all. He is burying his own wife. And even at that time, the commitment to his master is, Lord, take my life, my all. I'm ready to give you everything. And he continued working. He continued working. And you know, at the end of his life, he couldn't walk. He had to be carried on a stretcher from village to village, but he wouldn't stop practicing even medicine for the villagers at that time. And also, the medicine that would serve them eternal life. And finally, one day he was very sick and he told them to take him back to his room. They took him back to his room and they were about to put him onto his bed. He said, don't put me on my bed, put me on my knees. And it is said in that it's life story that it is said that, you know, the room was such a sanctuary that none of them could bear to stand there. And they left him, you know, in that sanctuary with him and his Lord. it is said that hours and hours passed, and some people came and asked them that we want to go and meet him. They said, just wait, he's in prayer. He was in the position of prayer, and hours and hours and hours passed, and suddenly one of the African brothers went in and just tapped on his shoulders and called him by the respected name that they call him. And as he touched on his shoulders, you know, David Livingstone fell and he was already dead. These are people who were not heard by the world. These were not people who were sitting and, you know, pressing on the Facebook and all those things to just see how many views they have got. These were people who were unknown to the world till their death. I think last time also I had told the story of Graham Staines. The only day probably we got to learn about Graham Staines was the day he died. He died in Odisha. He died in our vicinity. But we never knew there that a missionary like that existed till the day of his death. You know, we are looking for stardom. We are looking for popularity. We are looking for so many things that wouldn't at all count in eternity and heaven. But here are missionaries who really gave their lives for this Lord Jesus Christ. So many stories that we can talk about and I can discuss, you know, but woe is unto me if I don't preach the gospel. 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verses 16 to 17. Let me, Abby, 5 more minutes.
Yes, yes.
Can somebody help me reading 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verses 16 to 17?
For though I preach the gospel, I have nothing to glory of.
I have nothing to glory of, yes.
For necessity is laid upon me. Yeah, woe is unto me if I preach not the gospel. For if I do this thing willingly, I have a reward. But if against my will, a dispensation of the gospel is committed unto me.
Yes, woe is me if I don't preach the gospel. You know, it is so important to understand this. Woe unto me because his love constraineth me. 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 14. I will preach this gospel because I'm so much in love with this Christ. I don't have anything better to do than to prove this love, than to show this love. The love that has laid down for me his life on the cross. Oh, it constraineth me. And it the love towards God and the love towards men constrains me. Because if I don't preach this gospel, oh, this person is going to hell. He's going to eternity, to spend his eternity in hell. And so this love constraineth me so that, you know, I will preach the gospel. Woe unto me because his love constraineth me. Woe unto me because there is an urgency. If you read Ephesians 5, 15 to 16 and Colossians 4 and verse 5, we will understand these aspects. We need to work redeeming the time. We need to work redeeming the time. You know, in Colossians 4 and 5, it says that walk in wisdom towards those who are outside redeeming the time, who are outside the camp, who are outside the camp of knowing God. You know, work redeeming the time. There is an urgency. There are two things which make it more urgent. One is, I don't know when I will die. The second is, I don't know when the Lord is going to come. So there is an urgency. And I need to proclaim and tell people about this as soon as possible. Unto me, we must preach the gospel because it alone is the power of God unto salvation. Woe unto me because I need to preach the gospel because it is alone the power of God unto salvation. Romans 1 and verse 16. So, you know, then in Romans chapter 10, verses 14, how then shall they call on him in whom they have not believed? And how shall they believe in him whom they have not heard? And how shall they hear without a preacher? And how shall they preach unless they are sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who preach the gospel of peace, who bring glad tidings or glad tidings of good things, but they have not all obeyed the gospel. You know, you may go and you may share, all may not obey, but your duty is not that all of them may be obeying, but your duty is sharing the gospel. This is one of the verses that challenged my life as I came into the missions. How shall they believe in whom they have not heard? How shall they hear without a preacher? Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Now let me hurry up and wind up by saying, how can I be involved? How can I be involved? Yeah. You know, these are things that the way that you can be involved. Yesterday, somebody had asked me, are ambitions wrong? No, the ambitions are not wrong. But when ambitions are misplaced, it is wrong. So how can you be involved? You know, there are hospitals in Maharashtra that are at the verge of shutting down because of the lack of doctors and nurses and technicians. If you don't understand what I'm saying, you can connect to Maxlin and ask him. If you're planning to take up medicals, if you're planning to take up things which are, you know, related to the medical things, you can ask Maxlin. Or if there are people who are already nurses or are doing their studies for doctorate, you know, there are hospitals. But let me tell you again, why you involve over there is not for a fat salary. But it is because you are committed to God, because you have a mission to accomplish. You know, then there are vocational things that you can do during your vacations. You know, come along with us to interior villages. You can have, you know, medical camps and support us in the local work. The other thing that you can probably, any of you can do, is come during the summer vacations, you know, come out during the summer vacations and teach the children, because 80% of children in our Bastar, they fail in this subject called English, because they are not being taught the right way. It's not that English is so difficult. You know, what you can do is, by your finances, by supporting the missions till you get directly involved into it. You know, there are friends of mine who have probably not come back for their vacations from abroad. You know why? Because they separated that money and gave it to one of the assembly construction works that we were having. Can you imagine that? It was sacrificial giving. It was not out of their abundance. Haan, jo hai, chalo, ab bacha kucha. De do mission skill. No. They separated that. They kept all their luxuries to the side, even to the extent of visiting their parents and their family back in the country, so that could be separated and given for the work of the Lord. When I say this, let me remind you about one of the brethren who died yesterday. He has left a child who's 4 years old and his wife who's pregnant. And, you know, he was the only working person in that village. And so he had a home, and the assembly was gathering at his home. Now he's dead and he's gone. There is, you know, that is the kind of conditions that the missionaries are working in. oh, how much we need to pray for. You know, you can also help us in business entrepreneurship, like helping in livelihood programs. There is one of our villages where, you know, a lot of crop is being produced, but you won't believe they are not able to sell it into the market. And what they do, once the harvest has come, and if they are not able to do, they just leave it there and it just gets destroyed. They lose a lot of their income, but what happens is, even if they take it and sell it, they don't get the money for the transportation. That is 60 rupees. They won't get 60 rupees. So they don't take it. They just leave it for it to decay. But you know, you can come up. You can be a scientist. You can be you can open up an entrepreneurship. Probably you can, you know, do something with that, making pickles or training them to do all those kind of things. You know, you can always be involved into that. You know, let us go ahead. You know, this is one next field that is very immensely being used, but very often for all the wrong reasons. Media is the need of the hour, you know, and we need to understand, we need writers. You know, if you are talking about print media, there is print media, visual media, radio media, there are hoardings, newspapers, all these come under media. But if you look at print, we need writers, of story writers, content writers. You know, for the print, we need graphic designers. In the visual media, we need, you know, for the TV programs, we need for the web designing, web communication of the gospel. We need cinematographers, or, you know, people who handle the cameras, animators. We need people in the production. We need people who do music. You know, the sad state is, once upon a time, it was said that there was a major work that was being done through the radio program. It was said that almost 80 to 90% of the world was listening to the gospels just through the radios. But unfortunately, today, we don't have any proper contemporary radio programs. We don't have any of our programs on the FM. And there are millions glued to the FM, not now, but when the, you know, when people are traveling by roads, when the when they go to their offices, it is said that from 7 o'clock to 11 o'clock is the peak hour for people who are just listening to the radio. But we don't have any contemporary programs. There is nothing that we are doing about it. You know, hoardings and newspapers. There's nothing that we are involved in many of these things, in using any of these things. So there is a great need. There is a great need. We were doing a TV program a few years back, and at the end, we couldn't go further with the program because we were running short of funds. And I remember one of the brothers who was a Bible smuggler, I won't name him, from Bahrain to Saudi. You know, he was one of the brothers who was involved into this. And while smuggling the Bibles, while we were doing these programs, he would tell us that the major chunk of his investment was into this TV program. And the major people who supported along with his things was the laborers who were working over there. It was not the big people. It was not the people who had money. It was daily wages earning laborers who went back home, who installed dish TVs in their homes and said that subah 6 baje ye karyakram aayega dekhna. UP and Bihar workers, laborers, they went and put these TV for the villagers to watch this Sadgama TV program. And at one point of time, he didn't have money to pay to the ZTV. And you know, he said that he had to be taking up his wife's provident fund and paying for that. And when he was deported, For 2 years, they went through struggles because he couldn't get a job. He was fortunate enough that he was not hanged for smuggling Bibles. But because of the respect that they had for him, they said, immediately leave. They gave him his passport. He left. He came back to India. I remember talking to his son. He's a very good musician. One of the persons who's helping me in music, a very good guitarist. He can't afford a guitar today. For your information, his father was working with Harley Davidson, so you can know that how well he was placed, but left everything, came back to India as a pauper. He didn't have anything back here. For 2 years, he suffered. Great are the afflictions of the righteous. It's not that we can't do a TV program, but we can't come together to do a TV program. It was just 40,000 that we had to pay. 1,000 believers paid 40 rupees, we could have made it, But we don't do that. We accuse the media and the TV and for everything wrong. Yes, obviously, we encourage all these things for the wrong reasons. But we don't involve, there is so much to do, And I don't have time. I think I've already ran out of it. So let me stop. Let me wind. Oh, my dear children, if you want to understand more about it, please do come back to Jagdalpur. We've got a beautiful house the Lord has given us. And, the story of this house itself would be something that would be encouraging when you come here to listen to it. And may the Lord bless us. May the Lord bring people into missions. Each and every one of you listening to me, God has a mission for you to fulfill, which none other than you can do. And the Lord's, and let this commitment be there. Woe unto me if I don't preach the gospel. So whatever age you are in, wherever you are, where the place of your studies, the place of your work is where, if it's your school, if it's your college, that is where you ought to evangelize. God had only one missionary, and he sent him for you and me to die for us on the cross of Calvary. His name is Jesus Christ, the God magnificent, the Lord amazing. There is no better king to work for. Let us all come together, work for this master, the best and the good master. You can't have any better masters, and I'm so satisfied working for him, and I don't regret all the things that I've gone for him, and it is so beautiful, so beautiful to be working for him. And again, all that I can say, my life, my all. May the Lord help us. May these words be words of blessing and encouragement for us to be involved into missions. May the Lord bless us.